It really does rank in terms of some of the largest sizes of single unit LNG facilities in the world. It's an incredible feat. Canadians world over are known as friendly and polite people. I think we have that title globally. I'll let you be the judge of that. But we're also incredible collaborators and incredible partners. And you don't build a project like LNG Canada without deep partnerships. For me personally, as a Canadian, there's a deep sense of pride.
Hi, I'm Bryony McKenzie, and welcome back to the Energy Podcast from Shell. So today we're going to drop in on the west coast of Canada, going behind the scenes of LNG Canada. Demand for liquefied natural gas, or LNG, is rising, and what will it take to meet that demand? And how do you go about delivering a massive project like LNG Canada? Well, joining me today is Hadi Quazi. He's Shell's joint venture asset manager of LNG Canada. And that's a joint venture between Shell, Petronas, PetroChina, Mitsubishi Corporation, and Cogas. And it's just marked a big milestone. Shell's maiden export cargo set sail, delivering Canadian natural gas to global customers. So a quick note before we start. To ensure we're all on the same page, when we say Shell or we're talking about Shell PLC and its subsidiaries in general. The companies in which Shell PLC directly and indirectly owns investments are separate legal entities. Hadi, thank you so much for joining us. This is the biggest private sector investment in Canada's history. Give us a sense of where you are right now and what you do as the joint venture asset manager.
Well, right now I'm here in downtown Calgary in our Shell office. This is where our Canada Integrated Gas team is based. It's also where our LNG Canada joint venture team is based. And then of course, a little ways away on the west coast of British Columbia, we have our main site in Kitimat. And so along with a number of my colleagues, we collectively manage Shell's 40% interest in this venture. That's how I fit into this this puzzle.
For those of you who caught the last episode and heard Cedric Kremers, the president of Integrated Gas at Shell, talk about big global trends in gas, LNG Canada is an example of that story playing out on the ground, isn't it?
Oh, it absolutely is. I mean, if you take a step back for a second and just think of our global energy system, I mean, it certainly, if it colored by the last number of years, it's a system in flux. It's dominated by some macro trends. We've heard much in terms of renewable growth, renewable competitiveness, the drive on carbon intensity. At the same time, we've heard a lot about energy addition globally, which is still very much a theme. Another theme that we've heard in the global energy system, and that is always there and ebbs and flows, is energy security in different markets. And so when you look at it within that context, LNG has an incredible role to play in facilitating some of those key trends across the global energy system. And I'm sure nobody does it better than Cedric. I'm sure he articulated exactly where we see LNG demand globally. The key point for me is that LNG will continue to play an even greater role in the global energy system in the years to come. And so when you take that back and you look at it from a Canadian context, in Canada, natural gas has been a story that's gone on for many, many generations. Canadian natural gas is something that we have produced into the domestic market here in Canada and the United States for a long time. And LNG providing a pathway for our vast and expansive natural gas resources to access international non-North American markets, so markets over water, is a significant step change. And that's what LNG Canada provides. And then if you look at it from a global context, think of where Canada is and think of where a significant portion of the demand sector is in North Asia. I mean, on a global context, quite close to each other. And so there's this natural kind of connectedness between the west coast of British Columbia and North Asian markets, where a number of our partners in LNG Canada are from. So there's that's the tie between LNG Canada and some of the global energy trends and demand centers.
What's gone into getting this huge venture off of the ground?
It's a project, and I'll give you a bit of a timeline for you. I mean, this is something that's been well over 15 years in the making. If you think of it from the very first idea shipping LNG off the west coast of Canada through to all the work that went into assessing that opportunity, getting to a final investment decision, and then post-final investment decision, all of the hard yards to actually build this entire infrastructure project out. That included an incredible amount of work on the pipeline, just to give you a sense, to connect our gas resources in the northeast of British Columbia to the port of Kitimat, where we've built this liquefaction facility, a company that built this pipeline on behalf of our partners in the venture had to cross 670 kilometers and two mountain ranges to build this pipeline out. And so, you know, that is one major feat in all of this. And then at the Kitimat plant site itself, it took an incredible, incredible effort, first in module yards around the world, in China, vendor shops in places as far away as Italy, to build the component parts, to build the equipment, to modularize them. This was a modularized build facility, and ship them all to Kitimat, and then assemble this liquefaction facility out at the Kitimat site. And so thousands of people spread over really all parts of the world over an incredible timeline of, you know, well over 15 years, if you look at it from that context.
And give us a sense of those engineering challenges, because you've just mentioned 670 odd kilometers of pipeline, some mountain ranges, and I'm wondering how that worked out.
If you look outside our office, we actually have a few murals which depict the pipeline construction in progress, and it was quite literally in some segments going up, you know, the side of a mountain face, building what you and I would look at as that is a ski lift to pull pipe up a mountain and get
minus
it in a
skiers.
Position. Minus the skiers.
Yeah.
It's just an incredible feat to build the pipeline in and of itself. And that's just one component part of this overall system. In Kitimat, you know, we are talking about 14 million tons per annum, two trains. It really does rank in terms of some of the largest sizes of kind of single unit LNG facilities in the world. And so the work that goes into building that in a remote environment on the west coast of Canada with component parts from module yards all around the world, and then shipping it and assembling it, it's an incredible feat.
So Hadi, give us a step-by-step of how LNG Canada works.
It really starts in the northeast of British Columbia, where we produce our natural gas. So Shell and our partners all source their own individual gas supplies. For Shell, that comes from our operated Groundbirch asset. From there, that gas is routed into the Coastal GasLink pipeline, this purpose-built pipeline system of 670 kilometers, which then takes that gas and transports it to the west coast of British Columbia, where we land in the port of Kitimat. At the port of Kitimat, we've built our LNG Canada liquefaction facility. And so the gas is liquefied in LNG Canada. And then at the port of Kitimat, it is lifted individually by each of the partners. And so Shell, our trading and shipping colleagues, will bring Shell cargoes in to lift Shell volumes and then take them over to global customers. So that's a bit of a synopsis of the entire value chain.
And you said you bring your own gas.
Given this venture, LNG Canada is made up of five partners. Each partner is responsible for supplying their own gas, so bringing their own gas to LNG Canada. And then each partner is responsible for lifting their LNG cargoes from LNG Canada. And so at the heart of it is LNG Canada that is responsible for taking that gas and getting it very, very cold and turning it into liquid. And then it's shipped off by the partners again.
And you've also been working with local communities as well as part of the project. So as you said, it's expansive. So it would have kind of touched upon, yeah, different communities in that state.
I like to say, you know, Canadians world over are known as, you know, a friendly and polite people. I think we have that title globally.
I'll let you
be the judge of that. But we're also incredible collaborators and incredible partners. And you don't build a project like LNG Canada without deep partnerships. We've had to partner with all levels of government here in Canada. We've partnered with industry, both inside and outside Canada. And then lastly, and most importantly, indeed, you don't build something like this without a deep partnership with the local communities, and in particular, the First Nations and Indigenous communities across the Canadian segment of this integrated gas value chain that call the land, air, and water their home. And so we have gotten to today the delivery of this project on the backs of those partnerships. And the only way we will continue to operate for decades to come is by continued strengthening of those partnerships.
This is an engineer's dream, sounds to me. I'm thinking this ticks so many boxes of, you know, things on a huge scale, really complex challenges, really interesting environments to work in. It's obviously came across your desk and someone said, oh, could you be in charge of this? And you thought, well, that's a challenge, but I'm up for it.
When you take on a role in a venture like this, it's a pretty significant shift. I mean, I'm used to being in a technical operating domain in most of my career. And so LNG Canada was an incredible opportunity for me personally. I have this, you know, this long arc that kind of came full circle. I remember being an intern in Shell in Canada in our wells team in the months after we acquired our upstream gas assets that are the origination point of this entire value chain.
Now that the first cargo is shipped, big congratulations to you, by the way. How does that feel for you and the team on the ground?
For me personally, as a Canadian, there's a deep sense of pride. Really, there's a deep sense of pride that I mentioned when we kicked this conversation off, that the resource sector in Canada has been a source of prosperity to Canadians for generations. LNG Canada is the next chapter of that. You know, if I think about it in terms of the role that I play, it's a role that is on the sideline cheerleading and supporting many, many thousands of people who are on the ground in Kitimat, who have helped build this pipeline across the province of British Columbia, who are in the northeast of British Columbia and are operated Shell assets, producing natural gas and expanding our natural gas production base to feed LNG Canada, the many people who are helping support the shipping and lifting of LNG cargoes and looking at how to best optimize that. Those are the people who are actually doing the work. I'm on the sidelines cheerleading. That's kind of how I look at myself. And so for them, I mean, just a real recognition of all the time, effort, and energy. Right now, today, there are thousands of people at Kitimat. There are many Shell secondees who have been seconded into LNG Canada, right from our CEO of LNG Canada. They're the ones who are really, really delivering this for us.
Thanks, Haddie. It's really good to talk to you today.
Absolutely. A pleasure. Thank you.
And if you want to hear more about LNG, that longer interview is now available on our channels. And of course, you can subscribe to the Energy Podcast on your favorite podcast platform or watch us on YouTube. Remember that you can find Shell's cautionary note and references from today's episode in the show notes below.